5-minute crafts. There's many videos out there on this topic, some on the more critical side, others made just to poke fun at a trend that has rapidly taken over in the past couple of years. But I haven't seen a lot of videos to concisely talk about the larger phenomenon at play here. Why channels like 5-minute crafts are successful, what the effects are, and how the trend this channel is founded on is actually altering the creative market. Although these videos have pretty much become a meme at this point, there is a lot of fascinating stuff under the surface, so we're gonna approach this from a somewhat unconventional point of view. I'm also happy to say that this video is sponsored by the Ridge Wallet, but we're gonna talk about that a little more towards the end of the video. For now, let's take a brief look at the history of life hacks as a genre and how 5-minute crafts managed to hijack it, becoming a legitimate media juggernaut. According to Merriam-Webster, the term life hack was first used in 2004, signifying a clever tip or technique for accomplishing some familiar task more easily and efficiently. In a world of fast-paced, shareable content, life hacks quickly became a niche of their own. Starting around 2011, this trend grew exponentially. There was a huge demand for life hacks content, and under these circumstances, a lot of channels popped up around 2015-2016, such as Troom Troom, So Yummy, or the one that's currently by far the most successful, 5-Minute Crafts. What might seem surprising at this point is that the content they made back then was actually quite useful. There's no way of knowing whether the life hacks they showed were devised by them or just copied from elsewhere, but for, let's say, students or young adults who couldn't afford specific professional tools, the channel offered a lot of creative alternatives for various tasks around the house. I mean, I was a student once. I was broke as hell. Had I known that you can just put baking soda in a clogged drain and wash it down with vinegar and hot water, do you understand how life-changing that could have been, especially when you've lived in a dorm with three other students who never cleaned after themselves. I've seen things, man. I've seen things. So we see how 5-minute crafts started with decent content, but as they understood how to milk the algorithm, the focus moved from legitimately useful life hacks to whatever's happening over here. Why? The people behind it must have realized pretty early on that the quality of the content is not what was being rewarded, and that instead, making videos that people shared would ultimately drive their business forward. By putting a laser focus on shareability, 5-Minute Crafts started just making nonsensical videos filled with bright colors and manipulative visual tactics, oftentimes even neglecting the laws of physics. And it worked. Today, the channel is about to pass 70 million subscribers on YouTube. It has over 19 billion views. It's the number one how-to channel on the platform and the third biggest channel in the United States. But here's the catch. 5-Minute Crafts has nothing to do with the United States at all. The company running the channel is operating an entire machinery on the other side of the world, churning out content at insane rates, with seemingly no interest whatsoever in the value of what they're putting out, and unfortunately inspiring many others in the process to follow suit. Five-Minute Crafts is owned by a company called The Soul Publishing, which in turn is owned by two Russian gentlemen operating from Cyprus, a tax haven that famously protects the wealth and privacy of a lot of shady business people, most often of those known as Russian oligarchs. Now, does that mean that The Soul Publishing is itself a shady company? Probably not, but the coincidence should at the very least raise an eyebrow. On the flip side, they describe themselves as, and I quote, "one of the world's most prolific and popular online media companies delivering engaging and irresistibly shareable content for all ages in 18 different languages distributed via a social media driven cross-platform network." And that's a very fancy way of admitting that they are, in fact, a content farm. According to their own website, The Soul Publishing distributes content across over 100 YouTube channels and 50 plus Facebook pages that they own, with over 500 original videos produced monthly in 18 languages. And check this out. Last month, The Soul Publishing became the most watched media company in the world in terms of cross-platform views, topping mainstream behemoths like Viacom, Warner Media, or Disney. Now, on the one hand, I can't help but admire their grind, because let's be honest, building a business of this size in just a few years takes a considerable amount of vision and structure. But on the other hand, I can see the ripple effects of their presence on the creative market, and it worries me. When platforms like YouTube and Facebook reward this type of content, more people will emulate it. When shareability is more important than quality, why would anyone spend 100 plus hours on a piece of content when they see how much easier it is to apply the 5-minute crafts formula? And that's just the tip of the iceberg. Underneath it lies a much more dangerous question, that of child safety. When studying internet culture, memes, and trends, it's important to observe how successful ideas oftentimes influence what type of content is being created platform-wide. A great example of that is what's been happening recently on YouTube with Pokemon cards. The creative market will always follow and replicate ideas that have proven to work, most of the times, as is the case with life hacks, regardless of ethics. The life hacks trend has been pushed so far that it eventually started to become dangerous. 5-Minute Crafts made a so-called life hack where they teach their impressionable young audience to put strawberries in bleach to get white strawberries. Isn't that just quirky? Nowhere in the video does it say do not try this at home. There was apparently no disclaimer that ingesting bleach can have major harmful effects, and even the title of the video is 36 crazy fruit hacks you should try in all caps. It does look like they cut out the bleach strawberries part after causing some backlash, although the timestamp for it can still be found in their description. The top comments to this video are mostly in reference to how dangerous it is, with people saying stuff like, let's all eat bleached strawberries, what could possibly go wrong? I love how the description says, great desserts for summer parties, bleached strawberries just like grandma used to make. I'm waiting for the day these people have to go to court because someone's child has been hurt due to YouTube allowing this content. But regardless of the concerned comments, the like to dislike ratio of this video is disproportionately in its favor. And if you think this is only dangerous to kids, a 22-year-old woman from Birmingham, England was rushed to the hospital after following a similar life hack by food blog Delish, boiling 2 eggs in the microwave, which then exploded in her face, causing severe burns and leaving her permanently scarred. Furthermore, in 2019, two little girls tried to replicate a life hack they had seen on a YouTube channel called Mrs. Ye, which showcased how to cook popcorn in a tin can. The experiment ended in an explosion, leaving the 12-year-old girl severely injured and causing the death of her 14-year-old sister. This content is one of the most successful on the internet, and at the same time, because of how easy and quirky it's made to look, it's also one of the most dangerous to the people that watch it. The question then becomes, who's to blame here? Is it the creator? Maybe. But if one channel isn't making these videos, many others will. And there are plenty of them fighting for the number one spot. Are the children or the parents to blame? I guess they do share part of the responsibility, because at the end of the day, you need to educate your kids to not do dangerous stunts that can cause them harm. But expecting every child in the world to be well-parented is just naive. So is it then the platform's fault for allowing these channels to thrive and to print money in their content farms without any consequence? Probably. But then some voices would also raise the question of censorship if the platforms stepped in. So even here, there is no clean-cut answer. It's kind of a big dilemma. But one thing remains clear. Life hacks as a genre, in the way it has evolved, is a serious problem. And it's not only thriving, but continuing to pass milestone after milestone with no signs of slowing down. Now, I'm curious what you guys think. Where do we place the blame for these accidents that happen as a result? But more importantly, how do we fix this? Because this is clearly something that needs a well-educated solution. As always, I'm looking forward to reading your comments down below, especially the more nuanced ones, because this isn't as black and white as it might appear at first glance. And while you type your answers down there, I want to take a moment to talk about today's sponsor, the Ridge Wallet. Now here's something I thought was funny. Last time they sponsored the channel a couple of months ago, I mentioned I'd been using a Ridge Wallet for over a year, and someone left a comment saying the wallet looked suspiciously brand new. And if that's not a great selling point, I don't know what is. I've had this thing for exactly 1 year and 3 months. Here's the shipping proof, just in case. If this guy still thinks it looks brand new, it only goes to show the quality of the product. And I've really been taking it everywhere with me. This thing never leaves my side. I mean, it comes with a lifetime warranty. How many wallets do you know that have that? This thing is genuinely revolutionary. It's small, it's sleek, it holds up to 12 credit cards. It's RFID blocking material, so nobody can steal your credit card information with those card cloning machines. And it's just comfortable to have around. So hop on over to ridge.com/Andrei and use my code Andrei at checkout. That's A-N-D-R-E-I, and you're gonna get 10% off your first order, free worldwide shipping, and free returns. If you don't like it, send it back within 45 days and boom, you're gonna have your money back, guaranteed. So thanks again to Ridge for sponsoring this video, thank you for watching, and we'll see you again very soon.